so far. So
okay, can I get your attention, please? We're going to record the, he's having a little trouble with the live feed, but we can record the meeting anyway, so we'll begin that. Welcome to the June 22nd meeting of the Town of New Paltz Planning Board. If you wish to speak at the public hearing or wish to make a public comment, please sign the sheet over by Kelly. First up is the review and approval of minutes of the June 8th, 2015. I have a motion to approve.
So moved.
Thank you. Second?
Second.
Any comments? No. Oh, good. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Next up is public hearings. I have a motion to open the public hearing on LP Builders.
I'll make the motion.
Thank you.
Second.
Thank you, Peter. Does anybody wish to speak on LP Builders? I did, for those that are interested in it, I did get a an email from the applicant's attorney. They've hired a new engineer for the project. They determined to make a submission by July 20th and to be to continue the public hearing to August 10th. Anybody here for LP? Okay. I have a motion to extend the public hearing for LP Builders to August 10th, 2015.
So moved.
Thank you. Second. Thank you. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Yeah, should they give me any time to get out? I apologize. I'm going to try to keep you to 5 minutes. I'll start waiting. Got 4.5 minutes. I need your name and address. Speak slowly. We have a person here transcribing the meeting minutes, the speeches, so be kind to her. She's trying to write them down as best she can on it. So with that, I have a motion to open the public hearing on Trans Hudson CVS site plan.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, first up, Joe Haas.
I'll be like less than a minute. Joe Haas, 36 Morningstar Drive, New Paltz. I'm concerned about more cut-through traffic on local roads. CVS 5 guys will increase noise and air pollution, compromise safety for pedestrians and bicyclists.
Thank you. Wow, I'm impressed. Brian Allback.
Dr. Dean. Brian Allback, 23 Mill Rock Road, New Paltz.
Okay.
I have concerns, two main concerns. One about tax implications, and I think the board has done good work in taking into consideration the tax implications in this kind of assessment. CVS is likely to have an impact on other local businesses, potentially driving some out of business. and I think we should explore what the tax implications would be of that. In addition to the fact that CVS in particular as a corporation has a history of challenging tax assessments, they're likely to try to do that here, and that we should explore the tax implications of that. On the environmental front, I'm very concerned about the fact that this is adjacent to wetlands. As a community that experiences flooding on a regular basis, I think it sort of goes without saying that anything that's going to be of this size that's going to be built on or adjacent to wetlands, we need a thorough environmental assessment of that.
Thank you. Bruce, you want to speak about?
Yeah, no, I want to speak about
CVS?
No.
Okay. Go ahead, Bruce.
My name is Bruce Simon. I live at 122 Butterville. Advance warning, since I'm going to be discussing the law, I'm a lawyer, member of the New York Bar since 1961. First, I think we have to talk about what you're not here to do. You are not a new business development agency, and you are not a venting board for the public. You are a planning board. You have legal duties and legal obligations. And that's what I want to talk about. Your first obligation is to apply town code and the State Environmental Quality Review Act. That's not an option that you have, that's a requirement. So here's what the law requires of you. An EIS is required when a proposed action may include the potential for at least one significant adverse environmental impact. Notice the words may and potential. The courts have held that type 1 actions carry a presumption that they are likely to have a significant adverse effect. That is a low threshold for the preparation of an EIS. Presumption is not just a loosey-goosey word. It has legal significance. It means that you start out with the proposition that an EIS is required. That's the presumption. That's the opening bell. And the final, and that's the final bell, unless the applicant overcomes the high bar to erase it, which requires that you find that there is not even the potential for at least one significant environmental impact. You do not have to find that there will be a significant environmental impact, or only that there is the potential. That's not as harsh as one might imagine, because we tend to forget what we're here to do. We're here to protect the environment. The tool the legislature has given you is to develop the information you need through an environmental impact statement. It's only a tool. All you are being asked to do is to provide yourself with the tool that you need in order to review whether there is at least one potential significant impact. I want you to use that tool. It's hard, frankly, to imagine how in a proposal of this nature you would not gladly use that tool. Recall, at this stage of the game, you're deciding nothing whatsoever on the merits. This is simply the application of the legal presumption, unless it's overcome by a high bar and preventing you from using the tool that each of you would want to use to make the full environmental change.
Thank you. Thank you, Bruce. Peter Kaufman.
Kaufman. I reside at 6 Pinecrest Road in the town of New Paltz. I live on one of the residential blocks that's off of Henry DuBois that's nearest to the proposed site. And so, like my neighbors and myself, are concerned how this is going to affect the neighborhood and the quality of life. Like many residents, I frequently walk eastbound on DuBois and would like to know how this is going to affect traffic patterns that are going to be on DuBois as well as on North Park Corners. I also often drive there as a way to avoid turning left from Duzine onto Main Street. And again, trying to figure out how this project is going to affect that, and what the results will be. So as a previous speaker just pointed out, I'm aware that the EIS is necessary when the planning board determines that a project's likely to have significant adverse effects in some way. It seems obvious that this is going to have some sort of effect, potentially adverse effects, especially for me as someone who's walking on that road a lot. So I'd like to require the planning board require a full EIS for this proposal.
Thank you, Brian. Susan?
Okay, I'm going to try to stay high altitude, focus the planning board and the public on a few key principles of SEACR, and I want to thank the lawyer who went earlier because I'm going to be able to make one section more abbreviated because he did such a great job with his comments. But the first thing I really want to talk about is segmentation, and I think this is the technical term. The applicant's approach thus far does not remotely pass, this is the technical term, the sniff test when it comes to segmentation. Prior plans have shown build-out of a third pad site. Their own SWIP refers to future development on the northern part of the parcel. And that third pad site shares common parcel, common ownership, likely access, some utilities, and will exacerbate impacts such as traffic, loss of vegetation, and community character. And the law, the SEACR regulations, define segmentation as the division of environmental review of an action so that various activities or stages are addressed as though they were independent, unrelated activities, meaning individual determinants of significance. Now, why would an applicant do that? In my experience, one of the common pitfalls with respect to where segmentation is often attempted is an attempt to avoid a thorough environmental review by splitting a project into smaller components. And it's very clear that the law says this should not happen. It's not as if we don't know the zoning. It's not as if the applicant hasn't assessed the site and its conditions and can't figure out what the development potential of the rest of the parcel is. And the SEACR regulation has actually three criteria, actually a number of criteria, and you only need to meet one for segmentation to be a clear concern. And among those criteria are common location, common impacts, and common ownership. We have three here. So that really needs to be evaluated because you have to address that related to significance, and you have to demonstrate it's been considered prior to closing out or progressing your SEACR process. I'm not going to talk a lot about potentially significant impacts in the way that SEACR defines them, but I'll just build on what the prior speaker said, which is you only need to have at least one potentially significant adverse environmental impact to trigger an EIS. And there are at least three, and many more that other people will talk about. Traffic, I think, has been well established as a potentially significant impact. And I want to emphasize that when SEACR talks about significance, it talks about it really in two ways, in terms of magnitude of an impact and in terms of the importance of an impact to a community. And I would say with respect to traffic, we have both of those essences of significance. Community character has been addressed and raised with respect to fiscal impacts and economic impacts, and it's unequivocally a potentially significant adverse impact. And I want to emphasize that SEACR actually anticipates the study of economic impacts. This is not something that the community is asking for and is out of bounds with respect to the SEACR. It's not generic. And in fact, if you look at the SEACR handbook, there's even, in response to a specific question about this, an answer that says the following, and I'll read the quotes. A town planning board reviewing a big box development should consider the impact of the development on the community character of a neighboring village that might suffer business displacement as a result of the approval of the big box development. We're not asking for anything extraordinary here, just that the proper studies be done. Others have and will speak about natural resource impacts. I simply want to note that the applicant has asked for a special waiver of relief to identifying trees, and I don't know how we could possibly evaluate the impacts of vegetation loss and the ecological or sound attenuation value of those trees if we don't even know what's there. So this is something, again, that the planning board really needs to address. In addition to the potential for triggering an EIS, I want to say that an EIS is also an extremely valuable tool because it allows and actually calls for the evaluation of alternatives as one mechanism for potentially mitigating impacts. So for example, this might allow for evaluation of alternatives that could include a smaller store, a more thoughtful and contextual approach to site design, less site disturbance, less parking to mitigate traffic, and to mitigate impacts on community character and ecological resources. So the EIS allows that conversation to happen. And it also provides a clear mechanism, I think, for the planning board to retain appropriate experts to assist them throughout the process. This is a lot of work for planning board members. I know because I work with planning boards. And quite frankly, having the necessary resources to make that process predictable and reasonable are really, really important. And this doesn't have to be complicated. There are many planning firms that have the ability to retain the range of experts needed and to coordinate the process so you have a single point of contact with the planning board. This doesn't have to be, you know, some big group of people that have to be involved and get very complicated. So what should come next? Since the entire action is inherently part of any determination of significance, I really feel that the applicant should be directed and requested by the planning board to revise their seeker materials, to revise their EAF and their traffic study, to address the full build-out, the full action. Once the public has an opportunity, and of course the planning board and the planning board's professionals, to comment on those updated materials as part of your continuation of the seeker process, I think at that point, you know, things can start to proceed. We're sort of a little bit stuck, it seems to me, at this point, and it's important that we have kind of a clear path forward. So that's my recommendation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sue. Catherine? Yep.
Hello, Catherine Stewart, 3 Old Mill in the town of New Paltz. Again, I think everyone has spoken very eloquently so far. Just as a teacher of math, I like data. I guess that's more statistics. But I like data. And I tell my students, don't make any decisions until you have all of the data. You really have a clear picture. I don't see any downside or any disadvantage to collecting more data and to having all the expertise at your hands. Susan talked about, you know, having a planner help coordinate all the experts. But certainly the positive declaration and an EIS will give you the data, will give you the data that you need to move forward. So that's what I have to say today. Thank you so much again for your work, all of you wonderful volunteers.
Are you getting happy because it's the end of the school year?
Well, not quite, but I'm done grading all the regions.
Okay.
I love my job. I've been sad this time of year.
Julie?
Often it was written as if there wasn't a wetland across the street, although they did mention at one point, but there are many points where they really do need to mention that there's a wetland and the wetland is connected. I've been in that wetland. I've looked at the culvert that receives water from underneath North Putt and in that corner, and that water water gushes out. There's water flowing that flows through a wetland, and it doesn't look emergent to me. It has the wetland indicator plants, which are the sensitive fern and the cattails, and lots of hostas and ticks and all that. But that water flows. You can hear it flowing straight to this pond, and that pond has an outlet. I've been right there, and you know that outlet absolutely goes right to Tributary 13. And that water is flowing, and when a storm comes, that water flows even more, you know. So we need to... Millbrook Preserve has a plan for how the watershed should be treated and things that could go on in the watershed. And Michael O'Donnell, I believe, is going to mention later how, you know, some specifics about how, in fact, really is a part of, this site is part of the the Millbrook Preserve, Tributary 13 watershed. And I'd like to talk a little bit about habitat, especially, you know, this, you can just look into that site and see that there are many trees above 12 inches in diameter, many, many, and it's a wonderful habitat. The canopy is thick. It invites birds, migrating birds, birds that live nearby. As I pointed out last time, there was, I found a great blue heron rookery that basically, I, you know, great blue herons do use forests, not just wetlands, to forage in the winter. They're looking for the small animals that are under there. In the Millbrook Preserve, recently I was with a person who knows birds, and she's heard a Cooper's hawk. That's a bird of special interest in this area. Also, my neighbor just told me that she heard a red shoulder hawk, and that's a bird of special interest. And also, my neighbor told me that on my very street, there's a red shoulder hawk pair that certainly needs forest to forage in, and they need, you know, the birds that live in a great canopy, and which, you know, that the forest that this site is hoping to, you know, get rid of, it's a great habitat, and I can't imagine, you know, how we would proceed without having a study that shows what's there. You know, the EAF says there's typical flora and fauna. Well, how do we know? How do we know that there's nothing? And, you know, they say the DEC says that there's they have not found anything there that's a threatened species or in danger or a species of special concern. But that doesn't mean there isn't anything there. There hasn't been a study. No one's produced a study that shows, in fact, no, there isn't anything. So we kind of have to assume there is something there. Otherwise, we're just sort of going, I don't know. But there's also, you know, there are parts that are wet, could be a vernal pool. You know, there's a large area that has intermittent water. There's an area that has wetland indicators right on the other side of North Putt. There's cattails and sensitive ferns there. So we need a wetland study that shows, you know, and it could be hydrologically connected. It's right in the middle of a lot of other wetlands. I've been looking at some satellite images of this area, and you can see what a wonderful, you know, parcel of land. It's used by animals that need to travel from place to place. It's called a connected habitat. It's really essential. If you look at it on a satellite imagery, you see that it's a place that is a connector between areas that are wetlands. And wetlands are like one of the most biodiverse, you know, places on the earth. So we really would be, we don't know what we're risking by losing this land. And I really do take issue with the segmentation that they're talking about. Well, we're only, you know, we're only talking about this much habitat loss or this much tree destruction, when in fact they're really looking to do almost 6 acres, which is really a lot. I wanted to also mention something about the. Oh, look, 1 second. A couple other not quite related things. In the EAF, they did not mention that there's residential neighborhoods, and they're up to, you know, they're about 1,000 feet away in two different directions. They mentioned that noise isn't going to be a problem during construction. They went to check off no, that, you know, that's not at all acceptable. They don't mention that removing, they have no checked off, in fact, they didn't check it off. But they didn't check off no or yes. Will it actually remove existing natural barriers that could act as a noise barrier or screen? So I'm trying to just point out a couple things that I found that perhaps you have found too, but it just shows that this is really incomplete. It needs to be revised before the seeker process starts. And it just, you know, it's a service to our town to have this redone and appropriately examined, so that these errors and omissions don't stand, because this is really not acceptable. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Kevin?
Hi, Kevin Borden, 12 Calvin Boulevard. And thanks again to the planning board for your tireless volunteer service. Really appreciate that you've kept the public comment period open. It allows us to kind of hear from other folks in the community about what their concerns are. Already spoken twice, so not much to add at all. So really in full agreement on the comments that have been shared by many, many others in our community regarding the potential detrimental impacts this proposal will have on our local traffic patterns, our local tax coffers, our community's character, including potential harmful impacts on the health and well-being of our existing ecosystem of locally owned businesses, not to mention our environmental ecosystem. So one additional level of concern that came up, and I really thank the planning board for posting the letters from both Chief Weeks and Chief Snyder. So the street that we live on, Calvin Boulevard, we're actually surrounded by seniors, which is great. We have a 5-year-old and a 3-year-old, so we have like 7 sets of grandparents. Our house has actually now become this like dumping grounds of toys, which has been wonderful for the boys. A lot of those seniors are going to face an increased likelihood of emergency services as they age. And given what Chief Weeks and what Chief Snyder said, expressing concerns regarding traffic congestion and the redesign of the intersection, we would like to ensure that one of the key elements of an EIS include an independent traffic consultant that looks at the potential impacts of emergency service response time, which is really important to us. So really, given the variety and depth of concerns that have been shared, we're asking that the planning board require an EIS for this proposal. So again, thanks for your time and attention to this matter. Happy night. See you soon.
Thank you, Kevin. Ann Quinn.
I live on the oldest street in the United States with the existing houses. I live in the heart of the historic district, and I have for 27 years, where we see countless tourists on a daily basis coming to our community, spending enormous amounts of revenue here in New Paltz. This is a community that is steeped in history. The natural beauty that we all live in and enjoy is second to none. The gunks mock the Himalayan mountains where people rock climb in training for going to the Himalayas. We have paddling, we have kayaking, we have thousands of acres of the Mohawk Preserve, the Walk Hill River, the rail trail, extensive biking, rock and snow. The natural beauty and the recreational area that we're afforded is second to none. Joe Ariel, the village attorney, called New Paltz the jewel of the Hudson Valley. I think Joe had it right. I see the character of our community hugely threatened by the possibility of CVS and Five Guys coming to our town. Specifically, our local business owners cannot stand up. I'm speaking primarily of Diedrich's Pharmacy, who has served 4 generations in this town for over 50 years. They have given and given and given to every charity that has knocked on their doors. I think of Mike Beck, P&G's, Garvin at Shea O'Brien's, and others. Shea O'Brien's has done more for Family of New Paltz than almost anyone. These places, these local business owners give and give and give. They can't stand up against this. And I think no matter how many studies we do, we know that. We don't need to do a study on traffic. We know what it's going to do. What I am concerned with is that this is going to have an enormous impact on the character of this community. And I don't see it giving anything to us but additional problems. I think about Joni Mitchell's song, many of us remember Joni, Yellow Taxi. They don't know what they've got until it's gone. And when it's gone forever. They paved over a paradise and they put up a parking lot. I hope we don't pave over paradise to put up CVS and Five Guys. I don't have the data, I don't have all kinds of statistics. But people that are already making so much money they can't count it have little to offer us here other than problems and a compromising of the character of this town. Those of us that live on Huguenot Street have worked very, very hard to maintain the integrity of the historic district, with some success, I must say. I think now that has to be expanded to the integrity of our entire town, our village and town, which I see at stake. Because we all know, and again, how do I know? I know because I've lived a lot of years, that this kind of thing doesn't stop with CBS and Five Guys. You wake up and you're living in every town USA. I mentioned this last week, a very, very dear friend of mine, lifelong Hyde Parkers, her father worked for the Roosevelts, said that one day they woke up and their town had become a strip mall. She said they didn't even recognize it, it happened overnight. That's the FDR house, the church where he worshipped, Valkill, Vanderbilt's, the culinary, drive down Route 9 sometime and see what it's turned into. And it happened overnight. So I'm just going to kind of refer back to Joni Mitchell's lyrics. They never know what they've got until it's gone. And when it's gone forever. Forever is forever. They paved over paradise to put up a parking lot. Thanks.
Thank you. Ingrid?
I'm Ingrid Hughes. I live at 9 Lucene Road. And just let me tell you a little something about Duzine. Duzine is not a historic road. The only historic thing about it is the name, Duzine. But it's got a very charming quality because so many people walk up and down it. Whole families, three generations, grandmas, strollers, dogs are making their peaceful way up and down Duzine, and I don't see how that peace can be maintained. And as I understand it, there's no assurance at all that it will be maintained if this project goes through. So I am very concerned. My husband and I bought a house there just a year ago because it was such a pleasant place. We came to New Paltz just 5 years ago because it's such a charming little town. Let's have charm. Let's have people first. Let's have a quiet environment for pedestrians and citizens of New Paltz. Thank you.
Thank you. Sasha?
City, you know, I live in another walkable town, and you can walk to the library. When I tell my friends who live in Tallahassee, Florida about that, they're like, that's lovely. You know, it just sounds like the holy grail of places to raise children. And our street is a lovely place for our kids to run around on the street. My daughter runs to her grandma's house around the corner. Okay, I told her not to, but anyway, it's our children play in this air, they breathe this air, they stand on Du Bois Road to wait for their bus, my children and the other children up the block, my child. And already, you know, I couldn't fail to notice that we do have a lot of noise from this throughway, and we do have a lot of traffic on this street. And I did notice that, you know, I can't turn left on Main, that I have to go around, and that people honk at me at South Putt because I don't make a right on red because I'm looking at like 50 different things. I'm like, I honestly, next time I'm going to get out of my car, I'm going to just be like, I'm sorry, I can't do this. You're honking at me. It makes me more nervous. Please don't do that, okay? So my point is that it's already quite a stressful experience, and I did move here for the bucolic, you know, Pinecrest Road, and I want to live that dream, and I don't want my property values to go down, and I want to know that the town I moved into, that they take all these things very seriously, and that they would do everything, you know, in their power to research and collect what they need to make this decision for our children, for us, for our seniors, for the people of the Falls. So thank you for welcoming me to your town, and thank you for your attention to detail on this project.
Thank you. Mary Ann?
For 25 years, whenever I exit the thruway and take a left onto Route 299 to get home, I say to myself, I'm so lucky to live here. Visiting friends always comment on what a charming town New Paltz is. They don't say, wow, you have so many places to buy toothpaste. I moved to New Paltz 25 years ago to be with like-minded people who care about our trees, wetlands, wildlife, air quality, and noise levels. People who believe their quality of life depends on the way we care for our environment. How will Omega CVS help us protect and nurture our greatest asset, our environment? There are many projects to come. Hopefully 25 years from now, I will still say, I'm so lucky to live here.
Thank you. Michael. Zergler. I apologize. Can't sit next to two Michaels, okay?
Hi, Michael Zeeler, 2 Henry Court, New Paltz. Thank you all again. There's three things I'd like to talk about in terms of this project. The first one I mentioned last time, but since the applicant wasn't here and nor was the chair, I think it bears bringing up again. That's the issue about your Planning Board's traffic engineer. CME appears to have a conflict of interest. It's clear that they have worked for CVS as their traffic engineer at least three times in the last 10 years or so, including as recently as 2013. That information should have been publicly vetted to the Planning Board and a public decision made about whether or not to hire them and what would permit that. If this is new information to you, then that's troubling. And if it's not new information, then whatever session it was in which you all just agreed to hire them, that I'd like those proceedings to be public. And I would also ask that to avoid any even appearance of conflict, that a new traffic engineering firm be used by the Planning Board. The second thing I want to talk about is that Part 1 of the EAF was recently resubmitted by the applicant using the current form, and thank you very much for doing that. So an analysis of that by myself and a number of other people have pointed out that although it's been filled out, it is inadequate. There are numerous places where information is incomplete or answers are given where it would be impossible to know how much, whether to answer yes or no. There just isn't enough information, and a number of places where answers are wrong. So along with others, I would ask that they revise and resubmit that to you. I've submitted a heavily annotated version, which I sent late this afternoon to Kelly, and so hopefully you all will get that sometime this week. So I won't go into details about that, except to say that the single most important thing is that it's impossible not to ask them to do a full potential build out of the site. They've made it clear, as Susan already said in their SWIP, they have said, and I quote, future development intent will not allow us to provide a permanent dedication of open space on this project. I'll come back to that particular point, but they're not hiding the fact that they intend to fully develop this site, and therefore this environmental assessment should include that in every respect, including part one. Finally, I actually would like to turn to something that hasn't been discussed very much, which is the stormwater pollution and prevention plan. Not in any great technical detail, but one of the questions that's asked in part one of the EAF has to do with whether or not the applicant has done everything possible to minimize impervious surfaces, maximize the use of pervious surfaces, and do things of that sort. And they answered that they had, and I would challenge that that's a completely false answer. And if you go to their SWIP, there are a number of places where they indicate that they've done things that really could be done differently. So for instance, they could, it's asked that they delineate and place into permanent conservation undisturbed forests, among other things. And they say they can't do that because they plan to develop the entire site, as I just pointed out. It asks that you consider limiting clearing and grading to the minimum amount needed. And they give an answer that is somewhat technical, but my sense is that if you're going to clear cut thousands of trees, 4 to 6 acres, and then bring in somewhere at a minimum 33,000 cubic yards of soil, you're not minimizing your impact to the site. And I think that's really the essence of what I want to say, is that, as I said at my first comments, is that so much of what's wrong with this project proposal, in addition to the presentation of information by the applicant, is that they've made no attempts at all to really try to consider the site. They simply want to take this land and turn it into what they want it to look like, which is completely cleared, foreign soil brought in, and then a plateau that sits 20 feet above the thruway with their building on top of it. There are so many things that the planning board has at your disposal. You have a very good clearing and grading law and a very good steep slopes law, and potentially, if it comes up, a good wetlands law. And I just want to note that, for instance, your clearing and grading law says that appropriate measures shall be taken to preserve significant wooded areas, including their root systems which exist on the site. The clearing and grading plan shall preserve natural terrain, watercourses, and drainage areas, and natural fertility of the soil shall be preserved by disturbing as little of it as possible. These are things that the planning board needs to ask in the clearing and grading plan, and things that you are required to consider. The word shall, as you all know, is a legal term that means it must be done. So for them to consider not even wanting to look at what trees are on the site because they say they plan to cut them all down is in direct violation of our clearing and grading law. So in conclusion, I would say that I would strongly ask you to consider the situation with the traffic engineer, and if necessary, hire a new one. Ask the applicant to provide a revised EAF that avoids segmentation, that corrects errors, and improves incomplete answers to the best of their ability. As already pointed out, traffic studies should be revised, and I would also ask that you reconsider the SWIP in the context of your clearing and grading and steep slopes, and see if, in fact, there aren't ways that they could use green infrastructure and other ways to mitigate impacts other than just through extensive engineering. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Michael. Stana?
Hi, my name is Stana Weisberg, and I live at 21 Cooper Street here in New Falls, just up the hill. I'd like to speak to the health concerns, both humans and wildlife. There are several things to take into account. 1,650 triaxle truckloads is the estimate for bringing in the fill to raise the, to raise the site. The fact that there's going to be a drive through there, the fact that there's more congestion that will be caused, which results in more idling, and losing the trees, which filter the air for us, are all gonna make significant impacts on both human and wildlife health. And in particular, the fact that the highway is right there, and all of the trucks that are going to be brought in to do the fill, as well as all the trucks that are going to be coming in throughout their life there, because they're going to be bringing in all the goods that they're selling. Diesel is a big concern of mine. So, diesel exhaust contains more than 40 toxic air contaminants, and in particular, you know, a large scientific body of evidence has shown the diesel exhaust exposure is associated with adverse pregnancy outcomes, increased risk for asthma, reduction of lung development, and adverse effects on neurodevelopment. There's also an increased risk of lung cancer caused by diesel. There's an estimation of the human health costs of outdoor air pollution range from $14 billion to $55 billion annually. And a substantial portion of that is due to the cost of asthma. Trees and other vegetation promote air quality by taking up pollutants through their leaves and diffusing them into their cells. Pollutants include nitrogen dioxide, carbon monoxide, sulfur dioxide, ozone, and particulate matters of 10 microns or less. And studies show that open space, park greenways, and all these other spaces like we have there increase property values. So that's another issue that I'd like to speak to as well. Diesel exhaust and many individual substances contained in it, including arsenic, benzene, formaldehyde, and nickel, have the potential to contribute to mutations in cells that can lead to cancer. In fact, long-term exposure to diesel exhaust particles poses the highest cancer risk of any toxic air contaminant evaluated by the OEHHA, and that's, sorry, it's on another page. That is the Office of Environmental Health Hazard Assessment in California. Sorry. Different things. So in looking at this, in seeing the way that we're going to be removing a whole lot of trees, specifically that are a barrier to all of these particulates coming from the highway, as well as the impacts of all the trucks that are going to be coming into New Paltz itself, it shows the real need for an environmental impact statement for all of us. And then in addition to that, great blue herons are another thing that Julie mentioned that I think needs to be spoken to. Give me one second. So herons are classified as a species of special interest in New Jersey. Not yet endangered or threatened, but that's coming on its way, and it's also on its way here in New York. And wetland destruction has caused a decrease in heron populations from their historic numbers. Since the 1950s, habitat loss has occurred in an alarming rate in New Jersey and also here in New York, destroying wetlands critical to breeding herons. They're faced with shrinking nesting and foraging habitats, and that specifically was spoken to more by Julie. Also, you know, it's critical to protect our waterways. And when I speak to waterways, I'm specifically concerned again about the drainage from the site, and the fact that a lot of this could be going into Tributary 13 and other areas that we are looking to protect. From pesticides and other toxic chemicals, that's going to happen as part of the runoff there. They haven't been specific as to how they're going to mitigate any of the runoff issues. So I again, implore you to please get a full environmental impact statement and think about how all of the changes that are going to be made to this site are going to affect all of our health.
Thank you. Ellen?
Lighting pollution caused by
16-foot length poles. I believe we don't know yet what the number of those are or what the actual aura would be of those. But the other, which anyone from the village will fully understand what I'm about to say, is that I understand that one of the reasons the site was chosen was because of easy access from the thruway. And perhaps I'm influenced, but what I experience with alcohol-related problems and the increased noise attendant to that, where I live. Do we really want to make it easy for folks to come off thruway, buy liquor, and return to the thruway to continue their trip? Do we know the potential cost of an increased demand on police rescue or fire department due to folks coming off the thruway to buy alcohol? We live right across the street from the fire station, and I actually love living there despite the sirens, but I know that a lot of times they're out because there's an accident on the thruway. Do we know the statistics about what this says? Certainly, it's not a weird or unusual procedure to follow, and certainly not for a project of this magnitude, and given the concerns expressed by the community. It would provide the most objective information about the proposed project and provide the most protection to the community, which is, I believe, the role of the community.
Thank you. Michael O'Donnell.
Hi, I've got some specific comments on EAF itself. I'll just go through some of the points. C2, question A, B, it says, do any municipally adopted comprehensive land use plans include the site where the proposed action will be located? Answer, yes. But in the second part, if yes, does the comprehensive plan include specific recommendations for the site where the proposed action will be located? Answer, no. But that's not correct. In the 1995 Comprehensive Master Plan, I'm quoting here, it says, the land use plan has identified areas in the community as sensitive environmental areas. These areas are, and they go to include several. One of them is the Tributary 13 watershed, and that is the Millbrook Tributary 13. It says, the land use plan recommends that environmental protection under CEQA be accorded to these areas in accordance with community values while retaining the rights of the property owners. Until that time, the town planning board will give careful consideration to any development in or adjacent to these areas. And I just, that's a map of the white outline is the watershed. There's a site clearly within the watershed. So I think that definitely warrants consideration. The Millbrook Preserve Management Plan also goes on to make very specific recommendations. I won't go through all of them about the site, but it does say site plans, special use permits, and subdivision applications for development within the Millbrook watershed should be carefully reviewed by local planning boards with emphasis on if and how the proposed site design of the project may impact the Millbrook watershed. Let me go on to another question here. D2B, would the proposed action cause or result in the alteration of increase or decrease in size of or encroachment into any existing wetland, water body, shoreline, beach, or adjacent area? This is from the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. That's the site directly adjacent to the site, are classified wetlands, and definitely within 100 foot. I'll just go through some of these quickly. They do say they're going to discharge stormwater to adjacent properties. They don't say where, so I'm wondering if it's going to be one of these. I think that's a concern. I thought this one was interesting. Will the proposed action result in a substantial increase in traffic above present levels or generate substantial new demand for transportation facilities or services? They answered yes. And I find that interesting because in the traffic impact study, it's quoting, the CVS Pharmacy Five Guys restaurant generated traffic is not expected to cause any significant impact on the overall traffic operations. So it can't be both. One of these is wrong. D2M, will the proposed action produce noise that will exceed existing ambient noise levels during construction, operation, or both? The answer is no. I don't see how it's possible. I don't know how you can construct a building, fill it with soil, cut down trees, and have nothing above the ambient noise level. They were asked to check all the uses that occur on, adjoining, or near the project site. They did not check aquatic, even though this is clearly adjacent to the site. Another question, E3B, are agricultural lands consisting of highly productive soils present? The answer is no. But if I look on the 2010 draft master plan, it's very hard to see on this map But that area of 12 North Putt, the entire site is classified as prime and important farmland. And then the last one I'll go over is E3H. Is the project site within 5 miles of any officially designated and publicly accessible federal, state, or local scenic or aesthetic resource? The answer, no. And this, I'm sure there's plenty, but just within 5 miles, you've got the scenic byway, which is a designated scenic byway. You've got historic Huguenot Street, which is a national historic landmark. The Testimonial Gateway, which is a town-designated local historic landmark. Mohonk Preserve, which is a national historic landmark. Mohonk Mountain House, which is a national historic landmark. The John Burroughs Nature Sanctuary, which is a national historic landmark. And that's, I mean, there's plenty more that are all there. So I do think that you need a full EIS on this. The other concern I have, you know, last time I spoke here, I spoke about issues in the traffic study. I think there's also some sloppy work, and I think that's, I think we deserve better. I think we deserve adequate, thorough documentation on this project. And so I hope you'll get me to revise also these documents. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. Neil?
Hi, my name is Neil Batez. I live on 47 Elting Ave in New Paltz. And I just want to tell you a little story here today. I was sitting in traffic up at North Putts Corner Road, like I think we all do all the time. And I was sitting there with my brother. And I was like, oh man, I can't believe they're going to put in a whole big development there, and they're not going to do any impact statements. So I have a PhD from Cornell in environmental studies. And I thought I'd take the opportunity to tell my brother everything I learned. You know, I have published scientific papers, peer-reviewed, in the effect of automobile emissions on nearby communities and stormwater runoff, so I got a capital ordinance. And I stopped telling him all about it, and he goes, what's going in there? I said, oh, Five Guys. I love Five Guys. I kind of like them too. So, and I said, oh, CBS. Whoa, CBS. Be careful. And this is what they did in his town, and this is the story I'm going to tell you. They have a small town, fancy community right outside of Boston. They wanted to convert their town into a walkable, livable community, much like we want here. So they wanted the stores to be close to the road and not have these big box developments that go back like a million miles like we have a Stop and Shop. So they told CVS, well, we will let you come in, but you need to put the store right near the road and the community, and that's because we want to foster that sort of development. And CVS said, no problem, and they did it. But the planning board should have paid better attention, because once they did, they didn't put the door next to the street. They put the back of the building next to the street, and the door is on the back side. And now, as you walk down Main Street, you have a black building and then a parking lot on the other side of the street. So pay attention.
Thank you. Michael Lewis.
Hi, I'm Michael Lillis, 25 Duzine Road, and I'll start actually talking about living on Duzine Road. It's one of the residential areas closest to the development, and just I want to emphasize the noise pollution that this project has the potential to increase. There's a significant increase in noise in the winter months from the summer months, and the barrier that creates that noise barrier is the trees that are on this property. So eliminating all of those trees will have a significant, I believe, noise impact on the town. The next thing I want to talk about was there's this great natural preserve, some people have mentioned it, in the town and in the village. It's the Millbrook Preserve, and this property is in its watershed. And the town and village adopted a Millbrook Preserve management plan. And the management plan has recommendations for the town and village planning boards outside of the property, but in the watershed of the Millbrook Preserve. And I wanted to share some of the recommendations. Encourage residents, businesses, and other landowners within the watershed to use sustainable natural landscaping and landscape management techniques to minimize the need for chemical fertilizers, pesticides, and herbicides. Provide materials to educate people about the connection between use of these chemicals, water quality, and the Millbrook Preserve. The Town and Village Planning Board should apply watershed protection methods during permitting of new development, This should include buffers and the use of stream corridor easements to mitigate development impacts on the preserve. This is especially important when any future development could negatively impact the core preserve area. And it's important to note that the water on this property is going to flow into the core preserve area. Promote low-impact development practices on off-site with existing and future land users adjacent to the proposed preserve. Town and Village Planning Board should incorporate use of best management practices such as stormwater filtration systems, oil grit separators, detention ponds, buffering filter strips, and silt barriers for proposed facilities into site plans where significant amounts of pollutants, oil, antifreeze, brake fluid, cleanser, and fertilizers have the potential to enter the Mill Brook. For developments that may alter native vegetation, restoration and maintenance plans should be incorporated into the plan approvals. New landscaping plans should work to prevent erosion, maintain biodiversity, which this plan would essentially eliminate, assist in managing water flow, and provide screening to preserve the character of the area. The plan should include details on both ground cover and shrub tree vegetation and should cover short-term planting and long-term management. Such a restoration and management plan needs to take into consideration deer browsing. Consider use of critter crossings to enhance wildlife travel and connectivity. This plot of land really represents a key safe haven for a lot of different bird and animal species as they go from one side of the thruway to the other side and they make their way through what has been their natural habitat. And I'll finish with a couple of others. The town and village of New Paltz should consider creating an overlay district within their respective zoning laws coincident with the Mill Brook watershed. This overlay would serve to elevate the importance of the proposed Mill Brook Preserve to land use applicants and residents alike. Overlay zones are commonly used to protect known environmental resources. Such zoning districts require specific standards for new developments that are in addition to the underlying district. Overlay standards could include use of best management practices for watersheds, forests, streams, and wetlands. More specifically, possible development standards for development within the overlay consistent with this plan include, but are not limited to, creation of a stream bank wetland protection buffer zone of 100 feet from all wetlands and stream banks where natural vegetation is allowed to remain undisturbed. Okay. Prevention of stream bank or channel modifications, which individually or cumulatively would adversely affect water holding capacity, flood flow, and water quality and produce other adverse impacts. Use of native vegetation for landscaping, minimizing the use of herbicides, pesticides through the use of integrated pest management, and a review of visual impacts the development may have on the preserve. The land here is really critical, and the water that flows from that is all flowing into the tributary 13, and its protection should be a part of your plan. Thank you.
Thank you. Glad you signed up. Ira. Okay.
Listen to...
Name and address.
Oh, I'm sorry.
For the...
Ira Margolis. Listen to a lot of information tonight, a lot of which I'm not familiar with as most people. I am familiar with what I do and need that what is told. I heard things about impact, and that was the one comment I wanted to make. My understanding is that this CVS will have a drive-thru. As one of the many disabled senior citizens, I think this is terrific. I've lived in the village for 25 years. All during that time, I've watched the same village residents who are here complaining about everything, not allow businesses that they didn't allow and everything else, and never gave the village, I'm talking about, any concern, as far as I'm concerned, to senior citizens or the disabled. In my opinion, the only citizens that the village ever gave any consideration for were the people who live at Wetland Ponds who don't pay taxes. They can go to them, lay a plan before them, get these people to vote on something, and remind them, this is good, don't worry about it, you don't have to pay taxes. I'm sorry, as I've said many times, this is a town situation, not a village situation, even though I live in a village. The mere fact that someone like me will have a place to go, let me qualify something before I go into that point. I have been going to Diedrich's Pharmacy for over 25 years. I will not stop going to Diedrich's Pharmacy. I like them. I like their, you know, I like the way they are. I like the way they handle me. I don't go to Diedrich's Pharmacy for things that are covered by, you know, by Medicare, et cetera, that are not part of drugs because they are twice as expensive as everybody else. And in their particular case, unlike a lot of other places that I have to go for, I have to pay for it up front. They do accept the plan, but you have to pay for it up front. They'll buy it anyway for your money to get back. People who are living on limited incomes, this is a problem. So I like the idea of a CVS. It's going to have, as far as I'm concerned, a positive impact on me. And that's what I'm concerned about. I've listened to people, the same people, by the way, in the village, complain about traffic on Henry DuBois. These same people who live in the village, I didn't hear any complaints from them when the village board decided to allow the construction of what was going to be a mini downtown across the street from me. Why was that one okay? Maybe because, you know, I didn't understand the logic of that because there's going to be businesses down here and everything else. But nobody from the village came and complained about that. Nobody from the village complained about the additional traffic caused by Woodland Ponds. Why was that? Well, maybe because the trustees were in favor of it, and, you know, because if you look at the history of why it did, it doesn't hold. I'm not going to talk about, I heard a lot of things, like especially like from Mike, which impressed me, because I don't know these things, I know he does. And I know that when he talks about you have laws and stuff to follow, you have to follow it. And if he's right, I ask you to just, you know, listen to what he says, because, you know, he's done a lot of this, and I don't know. But I do know, you know, Mike is familiar with this kind of stuff about Seeker and all this other good stuff. The problem I have, I mean, these people come up here and talk about a walkable community. Well, that sounds great, doesn't it? The town of New Paltz is not a walkable community. The village of New Paltz is a separate entity. They want a walkable committee, and they want fancy trees, and they want this, that, and the other thing. Fine, that's up to them. I just don't think, because of the way I look at things, that the town residents have to pay for it. You know, how much of all of the things that these people say would they really push for if they were not subsidized by the town? And that I can say because I've been doing this for 25 years and I've got every figure in the world showing how every time the village does something or wants to do something, because they don't have a tax base and they are subsidized by the town residents, it costs the town residents more. And that's just not fair. I don't care about the subsidy, and I don't care about that. You want all of this stuff, people? Fine. Thank you. Good. Great. But you should pay for it. And you should be willing to pay for it and not have to take money from somebody just because you can, because this is what you want, and they don't necessarily. And again, I will just close by saying to remind you again, because it's important, that this is a town planning board, not a village planning board. Oh, one other point that I have to make, and I'm sorry, but they talk about the stores in the village and how we must protect them and this, that, and the other thing. And I would remind this planning board that when the college, and they haven't stopped yet, try to force that plan for a dormitory on the town residents, which would have forced town residents out of their homes because they wouldn't be able to afford to live there. I didn't see anybody from the businesses or the village or anybody else protecting it, because obviously they didn't care, you know, what happened to the town. I'm not saying you shouldn't care, but, you know, turnaround is fair play as far as I'm concerned. I'm sorry. Thank you.
Thank you, Ira. Does anybody else wish to speak at the public hearing? I have a motion to close the public hearing for tonight. I will have a discussion about continuation during our review with the applicant on the public hearing. Okay?
So moved.
I'll second it.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you. Back to the agenda. Application reviews. As I said, LP Builders will have something for us in August, or before August meeting. Justin, you're in tonight? Public comment sessions always get me screwed up. I apologize to you. The board always has a public comment session where we bring up people are allowed to bring up other issues they wish to discuss. That's not part of a public hearing. We'll go into our public comment session. And Mike, you want to?
Yeah, a quick comment. I guess I have to admit I'm sort of a planning and zoning kind of nerd. But part of the reason is because I like all these people, I really, and you all, I love this community. And I think one of the ways to really impact it is through our planning policies and our zoning. Unfortunately, too often zoning gets in the way of what it is that we envision we want our community to look like. And so I just wanted to mention two things to you all. I ask for your consideration. It would require going to the town board ultimately because it's a code change. So as you all know, there are certain constraints for the public that the applicant has to adhere to in this zone, which is business 2 or B2. And they're allowed 50% so-called lot coverage, which is in your definitions, and they're allowed have to have at least 10% open space, which is another term of your definition. So I was curious, lot coverage, because in their table they said all that they had listed under lot coverage was the total square footage of the buildings, 15,825 feet or something like that. So I looked up lot coverage in your zoning code, and it says, refer to coverage, another term. And coverage says this, quote, that lot area or percentage of lot area covered by buildings or structures, including accessory buildings and structures. It says nothing about impervious surfaces, no parking lots, no driveways. That to me is a definition that I would ask you to consider asking the town board to change. It means that they could put up on a 243,000 square foot site with setbacks and a 10% coverage, 10% offset for open space. Other than the buildings, they could pave the whole thing. Because impervious surface, you know, stormwater and all that, I realize, et cetera. But it makes no sense not to include that. And I should point out, although I couldn't find it tonight, that in your wetlands section, which is a different portion of your code, you do actually refer to lot coverage and mention the impervious surfaces. So like our code in the village, there are inconsistencies between two definitions for the same term. So I'd ask that you consider discussing that and maybe passing it along to the town board. It's a pretty simple change. It'll have a big impact. The other thing is I'd just like to swing back to something Michael Lillis said, which is in preparing the Millbrook Preserve plan, which both the town and village have adopted, there was a big emphasis on trying to protect areas outside of the preserve in this watershed area. And one of the ways to do it was to create a watershed overlay. That would require cooperation from the town and the village, something I'd love to see us do more of. And so I would ask that you at least consider among yourselves and perhaps discuss, and maybe we'll even could be a topic for a joint planning board meeting, to consider whether or not we could begin the process of developing a watershed overlay to help protect the Millbrook Preserve. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mike. Anybody else wish to? Yes, Ira.
I just very quickly want to compliment the town planning board for having public comment. As I found out last week, the village, and this doesn't surprise me, doesn't allow it. It doesn't surprise me because the village, as there are 60, roughly in my last calculation, 65% people who don't pay taxes, they don't care. They get whatever they want. They don't have to tell the public, and it's just bad. So again, I just wanted to compliment and thank the town, at least, for having enough interest in its people to have a public comment where people who have something that they want to say other than this can. And again, thank you very much for someone who lives in the village.
Thank you, Ira. Anybody else wish to raise anything at the public comment session? Okay, moving along, we'll go back to application reviews. Justin. All right.
Can I say something really quick to start out?
What?
Can I say something really quick?
Really quick?
Really quick.
Okay.
Well, I just want to say I have a lot of notes for
tonight. Have one.
But the public comments have been really helpful. It's really so inspiring to live in this town, listen to all this research that everyone's done. It's really helping us do our jobs. Very few of us are planners, and it's just really great. A lot of the notes that I have, I like go through every meeting, look at the public comments from last time, look at all the emails, look at all the notes, and you know, kind of gather things from there. So thank you, New Paltz citizens. That's my first thing. Then I have 20,000 others, but I'll wait.
Oh,
okay.
I appreciate it.
All right.
I think a couple of things we want to really go forward with on it is in discussions with the county planning board, we'd like to get them a revised EAF. I think some of the issues that were raised tonight you should take a look at in your EAF. I would like to get them the traffic study.
I'm surprised they don't have that because we had transmitted additional copies for that circulation.
If it went to DPW, it's not the county planning board.
No, understood.
Okay.
Two separate agencies.
Though. Yep. So we'd like that. Did we have anything else on that? Okay. And we're going to talk about some issues we have on site plan we'd like you to consider before we send it to them. Okay? And bear with me on it. We've touched base with Dennis Doyle, and they haven't seen the plan for a while, and I think we resubmitted to them. So that's one of the reasons we brought it up here.
Can I just one minute? I had a copy of their review letter from April 1st. So I know they have the latest site plan set to date. Our latest revision was February 16th. That was the last full set of site plans that was submitted to the planning board, and then it was also circulated.
Yeah, but
they
really? Okay.
Yeah.
I have to pull that one out again. We'll get together with that. I just, you know, he's talked about it, and so we'll make sure we have the county on board with it. The other thing I had is, I don't know if it's a, whether I leaned it out of the public hearing comments on it, but or out of the sky, but I really want you to take a serious look at moving the exit on Putt Corners back to the top of the knoll. It responds to three issues that we have dealt with. One is by pulling out from there at the top of the knoll, the person making a left-hand turn has a longer view of cars coming north on North Putt Corners. It allows for a lengthier stacking lane impact on if they're making a left on the, and making a left on North Putt to 299, it would allow for more of a stacking lane. And the third thing is it would also give those people pulling out a longer view of the traffic coming south on Putt Corners Road. I could consider moving the exit. I think those are the three issues that we had trouble with the last time we were with you about the short span. I think Lyle was bringing up about cars coming down, going north on North Putt Corners and not seeing it, and the same thing as coming over the knoll and not being able to see cars. We're really at the margins on that whole thing. So
I think that's something that Mr. Worstead mentioned in his menu. It's something that we can look at. I mean, I think the traffic study, I'd like to still get whatever it is that the county is asking for and get that to them now so they can continue their review, and that's something that we will look at, because I think our traffic study has indicated that we meet the thresholds for the stacking and the site distance and whatnot. This would be an alternative that we could look into.
Okay, I'm just pointing out that I have a real safety issue with where it is right now.
So can we continue with questions on the traffic, the site review, unless you want to just do each person separately?
No, let's do it.
We were told that the DOT is not going to allow for an exit on 299, correct?
Yes.
And we meet with the DOT trying to...
Yeah, we have it. We've been talking about it. DOT's has been working on this thing between county, DPW, and DOT. I was expecting that we'd have something concrete from them by now. I was led to believe that in the beginning of June that they were working and they would have something on it. Even as of late today, I think they were trying to get a conference call. So it's what DOT is trying to put together should be out shortly, whatever it is. If we want to talk with, they have something. I want to be able to see if they're able to ask questions on that.
Like the reasoning is what they're working
on? Oh, what they want to do for the intersection. What they want to do for 299, since they're the arbitrator of 299, and DPW is the arbitrator of Putt Corners. Making sure that they both agree on what they think is doing them. And then if we have questions on what comes out of that, we certainly can question DOT on, if we don't find enough justification for what they said they want to do, to contact DOT. Whether they attend meetings or not, I'm not always successful in getting them, but.
I still have the concern about the slip lane, and I just think that getting rid of that slip lane, or even just the fact that it's going to be two lanes instead of three, right? We're going to have two. It's going to be the same three lanes.
Same three lanes. Yeah. The third, the right-hand lane instead of a slip lane becomes a must-turn right at the intersection. So it goes straight to the light, and then you have to turn right. So it's like an exit lane, but the third lane is still there.
One thing I just wanted to add that, we had heard that the DOT and the county were to have a conference call. We had heard that was supposed to occur on Friday So we've been requesting their response really to our response to their comments. We're hoping that that joint meeting, you know, fosters a response that we can address, and hopefully address some of the concerns that you're asking for. Again, this LaPlaine item is something that DOT looked for us to remove. That's something that they had brought up.
What they come back with, I think, you know, I think you're looking for it. We're looking for it to see what the issues are, what they've proposed doing, and why they want to do it, and then to have a review of those things. And if we generate questions about them, then we contact and follow up with the DOT or DPW, depending on whose jurisdiction we're having issues with. So I'd rather wait to see what they're writing, or written, or finalized, because I think they're at that stage.
Okay.
And I thought they would be at that stage a week ago or 2 weeks ago. So I think it's, but that's where I think we are in traffic. Yeah, Peter.
Okay. Doesn't seem, of course, we shouldn't anticipate what they're going to do before they do it, but it doesn't make a lot of sense to just have an entrance lane from 299 and no exit lane. Because if I'm a resident of New Paltz and I know I just got off the throughway and I'm going to go to the post office, I'm going to cut right through your, I'm just going to cut right through your place and then take Henry W. Okay, that's the easiest way to go, and everybody's going to do that. If there's a traffic light there, the slip lane is gone, I'm going to cut right through you. Just going to drive through your parking lot to get out. It's going to be...
Could that happen? Yes, I guess, but then I think it's a policing issue that...
It's just like
any other...
Actually, against the law.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'll watch for the cop cars.
That's it.
I missed the meeting where we discussed the traffic study. My mom was in the hospital. So I just want to check, because it was brought up. Was that disclosed, the connection between Creighton Manning and CVS? Have we ever talked about that?
Oh, we can talk about it now. He's here.
Okay.
Talk about the work that Creighton Manning does, generally speaking. And
so obviously I'm with Creighton Manning. Personally, I have about 18 years of experience in traffic engineering. I've worked for, you know, many projects that developed, you know, retail chains. Currently, we don't have any projects with CVS directly. We do work for developers, just like Justin is working for a developer. Their ultimate tenant may be CVS. So likewise, we've worked with developers who have ultimately had a tenant, you know, become CVS. I think the conflict of interest comes in, are we doing any work within the town? And are we working with Trans Hudson Management? And the answer in both of those cases is no.
So basically, you work, again, the developer that you worked with that put that CVS in was in Trans Hudson.
Correct. It was Zaremba Group. I think they're out of Ohio.
It's the same situation that you have with this applicant and CVS in terms of the architectural appearance. They have no control over that. They're just a tenant, but the applicant doesn't control what the tenant does in terms of its business practice.
But when you're working for those developers, did you know that the work you were doing was for CVS's? I guess that's my question. Like, potentially.
Certainly, as you go through a site plan and you see who the tenants are, you develop that into, you know, developing your traffic studies.
Okay. It would be helpful to know what the tenant is based on the traffic that a tenant would generate, because I imagine from a retail perspective, if it was a high-end boutique, would be 4 cars coming in. If it was a low-end boutique, it would be more cars, even though it was the same square footage.
So that's just information, but I don't see how it changes anything. But okay.
I think personally, you know, the projects that I've worked on, I've reviewed more CVS and pharmacy type of projects than I've actually worked on.
Mm-hmm.
So it's been, you know, several years since I've worked on an actual pharmacy.
Okay, well, all right.
Can,
So we just have to
With the background on this one is to get our take on what the applicant has made for it. But clearly, the approval body on any modifications on the roadway is DOT, or in random case, DPW. So from expertise and traffic review, they're the ones that are doing the analysis of it and the viability of it and looking at the ins and outs that are projected on it. You know, if you're looking for the experts, that's who they're supposed to be, I would expect.
It's still, I mean, just intuitively, I mean, I come up frequently, North Putt, and I'm going to make a left out and go to the thruway. Okay. Now, there's usually 10 cars waiting to make that turn. How are you going to make a left turn if those cars are there? I don't care how you fiddle around with the light timing, it's not going to work. The timing your lights differently is not going to make the cars go away. The cars are still going to be there. Yeah, there's no way you can make a left turn out of there. So as far as I can see,
point is well taken, and I think that that's been a majority of the discussion so far. Our suggestions on the timing contradict what you're saying at this point, and we're waiting for DOT to get back to us if they feel the same way. So.
No, clear.
I just have a comment. I wonder what percentage of CME's income comes from corporate clients versus town and village planning boards. I'm trying to figure out what is your interest. Where?
Yeah, it varies by area. You know, and I'll give you this example. Our home base is in Albany, so we work for a lot of developers and, you know, essentially constructing things in that area. As you know, groups like Mazer work down in the Hudson Valley, they're working on that side of the table. And for us to work on the same side of the table up in the Albany becomes difficult. You know, it becomes a conflict of interest for us to represent a developer on one side of the table, but also reviewing on the other side, you know, in the same town. So we'll often come down to the Hudson Valley and represent towns on the review side of things, where we're not doing private development work. But I would say the majority of the percentage of income is from, really it's from the state, from state-run projects. And then the second is probably private development.
And again, your three consultants on the side of the table do work on both sides of the table. Meaning that George and Dave have represent applicants in different towns, but not in New Falls. So it's the nature of the beast that, and the number of different traffic consultants that are available in the area. That, well, with merger of Collins, there aren't too many different ones, and we've brought in Ken on a number of different projects in the town, and he has the best familiarity with the traffic studies in the town. So you're kind of lending on to his expertise of reviewing previous town studies, traffic studies, or applicants' proposals to develop that expertise of what the issues are in New Falls, as opposed to bringing somebody in and then bringing them up to speed on it. Clearly, we have a number of different traffic studies going on for applications before us now to ensure that, from our perspective, that there's a consistency across the board in those traffic studies and traffic counts. It's good to have somebody that's working and sees all three of them simultaneously, if that, to ensure that we're not running into gaps or missing things on it, that the Mohonk Preserve traffic study and the Wildberry traffic study are consistent that they're both counting what they're counting on, and if anybody else comes in and picks it and wants to do a traffic study, that it picks up the same set of data to begin with and same build out as everybody else going forward with it, that they're cognizant of that. So that's why we, you know, kind of used Canada's on a number of previous traffic studies in and around town because of the development of the expertise to get it in. Because frankly, we hadn't been doing that in the past, and we've done that for it. Okay.
I'd say so too that CME was hired by the county to do the countywide regional transportation plan, and that gave them a better sense of the regional aspect of transportation. That was another reason.
Go ahead.
So,
I have another
one. Another traffic thing? Anything else?
No, not a traffic thing. I have something else.
Mr. Chairman, is that a non-issue now? Can we say that?
You can say anything. You can say anything you want. No.
We didn't discuss.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I wish I had been disclosed in the beginning. It just seems like that. I get your point that everyone works for both sides. Everyone's tainted, and it's great that you're familiar. But it just seems that. I mean, I don't know. Maybe it's not general practice to disclose things like that, but it just. It has the appearance to me of impropriety, but this has been a good discussion. But it still has that appearance to me, and it's still like an independent traffic study, along with the five other studies.
Well,
and I'll keep bringing that up.
Well, there is one traffic study, okay, and that's the applicant does the traffic study. It's reviewed, by DPW, DOT, and our traffic consultant. And whatever they propose, based on that, well, it has to be accepted by those two entities and our consultant, and anything proposed to that for a solution to it has to be approved by them. What we're looking at from our traffic consultant is there some way better that DOT didn't see, or something that we can go challenge DOT, or, how do I couch that? They said this, doesn't make sense to us. How do we respond to them to get them to actually look at it? So I'm using Ken not only to look at the applicant's traffic study, but also to review DOT and DPW's recommendations for what's going forward on it.
Well, speaking of that, and this is something that people brought up at the public hearing too, but I don't know if you forget your concern, but this is traffic, but it's also an overall thing. Maybe now we could open up the can of worms of what is the harm of looking at the entire site and revising the traffic study to show the impacts with the third pad site included.
Actually, that was my question.
Wow. One of the things I wrote down too, I don't think we're far off on this thing. Just the background, we wanted to see what a full build out of the site was. They showed us another pad of 2,000 plus square feet up there. On the assumption that whatever that size pad was, a retail space could go in there. And impervious surface and parking associated with it, what would be the incremental changes to stormwater management?
There's more
impervious surface, but what do you do to contain it on site? That should be the better term. To address what the incremental impact of that third site would be. To get a handle on it. And I don't know, Elias, Ken, what it would be a type of retail space for incremental traffic issues associated with that. Again, it's a small space, but
Yeah, it's a small space, so it could be a single building that's split up into different tenants. You'll often see a building built out like that, and they might have one tenant, and they'll build to fit or build to suit, you know, the rest of the spaces that are in there. It's probably not a single tenant use unless, you know, they found something else in there. But if you were to assume that the whole thing is built out as that, probably the worst case would be some type of fast food restaurant. Second would probably be a type of retail use. You know, that would be, you know, just based on the square footage that you could put in.
Is that square footage, does that max out the allowable square footage, the 2,000 square feet? No. So,
from a coverage standpoint, that's your
from a coverage standpoint.
Yeah, no, we're well below the coverage requirements in the zone. Right now, we meet all the bulk requirements.
No, I think what the question is, we showed a pad there.
Yeah, we showed a pad. Yeah.
We showed the size of the pad, and that's what was, you know.
We showed 2,000 square feet.
Correct.
I mean, you could have showed 10,000. You could have, if you wanted to, probably shown 10,000 square feet. And I think this is where. You know what I'm saying? If you're well under your square foot allowable square footage, and people are concerned about segmentation, I think that unless you know you say that you're going to build less and put that in some kind of writing to us, you could conceivably cover. What is it, 50% of that lot in stores or, you know, in buildings, right?
But you can't park it.
No, you can't park it. There's a lot of things that go into
One at a time.
The thing is, we need to see the maximum build-out impacts.
We've presented conceptually what a potential build-out could be to this point. Right now, the application is the CVS and the Five Guys.
Well, I mean,
anything further that would go on, I'm sorry, to mean cut you off. Anything further that has to come back to planning board.
I get that that's your perspective.
And there could be changes in permits, things like that.
Yeah, I understand that, and absolutely it would have to come back to the planning board. But I think just in order for us, once this property is developed, it's developed. So I think that's why we have to look at every little thing now before it starts. So, I mean, it's nice to talk about right now really quickly what the traffic impacts would be, but if we really take into account that third site, it would mean going back into the traffic study and a million numbers would change, and I feel like that's what we need in order to fully look at it.
I think I have two questions to put on the applicant. You gave us a conceptual. We wanted to see what that incremental impact would be of using that as affects additional traffic count and as it affects
stormwater,
sewer.
Water and sewer. Actually, that site needed its own septic field, so that would be another thing. The second part of that one is if you go to the knoll for that exit, you may be precluded from building that third site, if I thought it out correctly.
Oh, wow, what do you mean?
Because to go back further in the property with a road and to come out on the top of the knoll there, that's where the other site was. Mm-hmm. So, right? Thinking of it?
It's in that vicinity, yes.
Yeah, it's in that vicinity.
Yeah.
I'm just saying.
But it's. It doesn't preclude anything to this point.
Okay. Then I guess we're at least at this stage of the game, really looking at the incremental impacts of that third site to give us a flavor of it, of what it means from the stormwater. From traffic and parking.
The other thing is, LaCosta last time at the last meeting brought up maybe having less parking and sharing parking with Five Guys. and
land banking some of the parking. Yeah.
So, and saving some more foliage, making the parking lot smaller. I don't know, have you looked at that? Do you know?
No, I mean, I'll just ask, I don't even know if the town does it, they have a land banking mechanism.
Yeah, I wrote that down too. The applicant getting back to us on land banking or sharing parking between two businesses, nor just exactly what you just said. Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
Something we could look into. I mean, right now we're at the required parking that we need.
Right. Yeah. What generally happens, what happens on some of these issues is we build the parking lot to the zoning requirements of the municipality. But our experience of CVS stores of this size, this is the nature and amount of parking that we generally get.
And
it may say that we only need 80% of that. So then the applicant can say, based on our experience at other CVS of this size, your parking is excessive of what we normally use or need. What we then say, look back at it and say, well, you have to build to the code unless you want to go for a variance, but you can land bank parking spaces. In other words, if the need comes up, you can come back and get your parking spaces, but if not, we have additional green space on it. So we've looked at land banking in a number of instances where it made sense to it. So I don't know what the major parking that, you know what the zoning code is and you put the spots in for that. Fine, but I don't know what CVS generally sees for a building of 13,000 square feet for parking requirements elsewhere. And if it's something less, we could land bank some of that parking so you don't create more impervious surface. We've used it before, and it's worked out well. Until we, you know, a lot of us have come in and said, you know, applicants have come in and said, we do have a lot of parking, and we really don't need all that. Can we do something about it? And rather than go for a variance to reduce your parking, we ask them to land bank it, and then see from there.
I think the traffic study has 10% as internal credit. 10% of the traffic is to use both, which would provide at least a baseline for reducing parking.
Similar to the trip generation, there is parking generation, and they're very similar in how they're developed. So the store itself, based on its size, there are studies out there that say here are the peak, you know, parking generation numbers, and that could be used as a reflection of how many parking spaces might be needed in any particular situation. Meaning, if the store is this size, here's how much might be used in its peak time, likely to be, you know, midday, not at, you know, 6 o'clock in the morning. That may serve as a reference point the planning board could use to say, we think this is appropriate, or no, we think this is too much or too little.
Did you guys look at that idea of the bike path through the site plan? I wrote that down from last time.
Oh, we did not.
Okay. Are you going to look at that? I just wrote down that you were. I'm just, just following up.
No, I mean, physically, we're already developing space for the shared use path along North Platte.
Okay.
299. So that's our proposal.
Okay. I mean, we had a conversation about it, but okay. All right. So, applicant not looking into bike path.
All right, let me see if there's anything else board has.
I went to ask, have you had a chance to, like, somebody did a sort of a analysis of the traffic study. Did you see those comments, or did you have a chance to see if there's any validity? I think they're pointing out some errors and inconsistencies, and I just wonder if you found,
if there's any merit.
Yes.
We did look at those, and you know, I'd say maybe half the questions are really relate to getting a better understanding of how traffic study is developed and the assumptions that go into it. So I think those are all, you know, valid questions, and they range from looking at traffic volumes from different times of the year and how does traffic vary over the season, down to specific comments about, you know, the actual numbers in there. So if I kind of give you an overview, some of the questions had to do with the seasonality of different time periods that the traffic counts were done. And obviously over the course of a year, traffic will vary. December, January, those are kind of your lowest months. People aren't out traveling as much as they are over the summer. So the DOT will do periodic traffic counts and they'll come up with these seasonal factors. Generally speaking, the time period that was collected varied from 2 to 7% higher than what the average is for the year. So if you were to take traffic volumes and look at it from January all the way to December, you'll have some months that are lower than average, some that are above average, namely the summer being above average. And then you'll have this kind of midpoint. So the months that they looked at traffic was all anywhere from 2 to 7% higher than the average for the year. They didn't do any, I don't believe they did any seasonal adjustments to bring that down to the average time of year, which I think offers somewhat of a conservative analysis. It basically gives them a worst case scenario in the sense of they're looking at higher volumes than are happening over the average. They looked at, or the commenter had asked about the background growth rate and how that was compounded. They didn't compound the percentage, they just rounded up to an even 5%. 1% for 5 years gives you 5%. If you compounded it, it would have been 5.1%. That 0.1% equates to essentially one extra trip on a particular movement, so it's essentially round off, you know, in there. There were questions about the traffic assumptions on how much traffic goes by the site that would actually enter. Pass-by trips and diverted links. And the pass-by trips are trips that are, they're out on the road already, they've got an origin in their destination, and they decide that they're gonna come in and likely stop at CVS to pick up a prescription and then continue home. I'll use that as an example. IT has done studies and looked at different land uses and estimated how much traffic actually originates as new trips, meaning I'm building a site and these are new customers that are coming here versus how much is actually originating from traffic already driving by the site. And a good example is a Dunkin' Donuts. You know, how many times do you leave your house, go to Dunkin' Donuts, and then go back to your house? Most often you're driving somewhere else and you're stopping in, you're getting a coffee or a donut, and then you're continuing on. Gas stations are another good example. There's really high percentages of pass-by trips. So they had used 10 and 15%, you know, respectively for those percentages, which are on par or lower than what IT assumes. They had asked, there was a couple of comments about design standards and the levels of service, you know, that were going on out there. There's a couple of comments about what's actually written in the report. Essentially, I would equate to typos. Their table of trip generation has an entry column and it has a second entry column. Well, that second entry column is actually an exit column. In one of the level service tables, they described a situation going from a level service C to a level service D. Well, the level service C was a typo, it was actually a D. So there are a number of comments like that. There are some comments about how much traffic is actually coming in and going out. Shouldn't these numbers be different? Shouldn't the entry volume be different than the exiting volume? And in some situations, it is. If we look at a residential subdivision and you look at the morning peak hour, there should be a lot of people leaving the subdivision rather than coming in. And at night, there's a lot more people coming in as they return home than there are leaving. When you have high turnover uses like this, restaurants or fast food restaurants, gas stations, those types of convenience stores, people aren't coming into the site and then staying there for, you know, several hours or even over a half hour. They're typically coming in, and within 1 hour, they're coming in and they're leaving at the same time. So that's why the distribution of traffic entering and exiting is often 50% or very close to it. The last comment, or there's a couple more, but there was a question about the 10% internal credit. And that relates to how much traffic is coming in and using multiple uses in the site. How much is coming in and going to CVS and then using Five Guys or vice versa. There are some, industry standards on that, particularly for, shopping centers. And IT has a whole matrix of looking at multiple land uses and estimating how that traffic kind of interacts with each other, particularly if they're complementary. If you have two land uses that are polar opposites, then there's likely not to be any kind of interaction between them. But in this sense, obviously, being convenience and being a restaurant, there's likely to be some type of interaction between them. So I think there were some really kind of fundamental, how does this understanding of the traffic study, comments, and then some specific, and correct comments on the actual traffic study.
Okay. No, I appreciate the comments. It clarifies.
Yeah, the 1% growth factor, to, go to how is that derived. DOT will do traffic counts on the state highways every couple of years. And you can take those traffic counts and, look at the data and come up with what the trend is. Is traffic volumes increasing or decreasing? So certain segments, Route 299, are actually decreasing. If you go from Thruway Authority out towards Lloyd, the volume has, on average, decreased. If you go from the Thruway into the Village, the volumes have increased. So looking at that difference in the volumes, they've come up with a growth rate to account for those little developments that aren't necessarily on the radar, those 2- and 3-lot subdivisions that don't warrant a traffic study, but they go into the influence of having some additional amount of traffic going into it. On top of the background growth rate, they also included the other developments that are known and ongoing. Obviously, Wildberry, the Hampton Inn that's under construction, the Foothills project. I don't know that they included Park Point, but I don't think that's kind of on the table anymore. So those things also come in and influence the actual background, volume that goes into the study.
Thank you.
Okay. Where are we going and what are we doing? I think what I'm looking to do is get basically an applicant take a review of the public comments that have been raised to date with a response. You've sought at some of it, but we're still in the transcribing because we just had one tonight.
Yeah.
So we'd be looking at basically a response from the applicant to the issues that have been raised. I would like.
Would that include a revised EAF?
If necessary. But, what I'm looking for from the board members are, and again, we just took notes today. But I want to see what areas we need to concentrate on that need to be addressed by the applicant going forward. And so we have some documentation on it. I'll give you an example of what I'm talking about. Obviously, the traffic study, issues on traffic, where DOT is and DPW, is a major concern and is a major issue. I don't have to tell anybody that, so we'll take a look at that. The extent that the other areas, for instance, the stormwater and the impact of the stormwater on adjoining properties. What it is, where it is, what they're doing to mitigate, where it is now, where it will be after we build this, and you know, to what extent that is, so we can answer that question on that's been brought up across the way.
That is in our SWIP.
It's just got to again bring it out. We did ask tonight, been brought up about the incremental impact of utilizing the third site, third pad. We estimated a 2,000 square foot retail access place that would generate incremental traffic and incremental requirements for water, sewage, and stormwater. What's the impact of that incremental thing? We'll go out and take I have some names for wetland inspectors, and we'll go out and do the walkthrough with a wetland inspector and a report back from that to address not only the site, what's out in the surrounding areas on it. But I'd like you to take a look, the board members, to take a look at what issues need to be by going through a seeking determination, going through what issues that we don't have answers for or inadequate answers for, so we can give it to the applicant to address in better detail. I would like to...
part of that is like if we had a habitat assessment, you know, study, like that would... I just feel like I don't have the adequate information to say what we don't have answers for, because all the information we've received has been from the applicant.
Generally, that's where you start to receive all the information
from. I guess,
But
so, do you want those?
I mean,
now,
I guess that's what
In general, I want to be able to give the applicant some guidance of where the areas, without sitting down here and saying, "Did I miss anything in a public session?" Because I take terrible notes, but I want to review them again and be able to sit down and read and then write down what I think are issues on it. But I would like to be able to give the applicant something that is that he can go back in and say, okay, we can address this issue, or we did address this issue, here it's where it's located, here's where we set it, so we can come back and say we've covered that area, or we've talked about that area on it. Those are what I'm looking for from the board members over the next, to the extent we can get it to them before the end of the month, it would be helpful. We'll send them all into Kelly, and then we'll consolidate them for it. But it gives us an opportunity to go over the, knowing full well that the transcript from this one may not be there in time, but it gives us an opportunity to read and review the other transcripts and to see what was and the things that have been submitted to the board in written comment, to be able to give it back to the applicant as looking for responses to it.
Will we have an opportunity to talk without the applicant right here about the letter?
Yeah, we're going to do that next.
Okay.
So there's those are the things that we want to do. We've talked about it. We intend to send a letter.
This is the architectural.
Yes, to the CEO when we're drafting a letter with the board members reviewing it. But to give you some idea, we'll definitely copy you on the letter. Is there anything else that we want to bring up while Justin's sitting in front of us?
I think a lot of people had asked for some more drawings of like throughway view.
Yeah.
View from the other angle. There's some confusion with the actual height.
We're putting together that view. We will be doing that.
Okay.
A couple other things.
Okay, I know that was one of the errors.
That was
one. Let me see what we can do to get together sooner than later. One or two things I wanted to just point out. We did get all our responses back from emergency services. We will provide written responses to those on that. I think they were, Mr. Weeks, the fire chief there, had comment about the stacking, so we'll look to address that. And then Chief Snyder also had concerns about the site distance and then placement of the bike ped lane on 299. So we'll provide full responses to those.
There's also seems to be a lot of comments about alcohol coming from the public. And I was just curious because I've never been in a drugstore in New York State that sells hard alcohol. I think it's only beer that they sell, but I was wondering if there's something else involved.
You don't sell wine.
You sell beer and wine.
I think that's the case.
You can't buy wine at a drugstore.
That answer, though.
Not in New York.
No,
yeah, they go. They just drive down to ShopRite and get it. I mean,
you can get rubbing alcohol.
Yeah. Oh, please, let's not go there. Go ahead.
One other. I just want to put out there. I think we've had the public hearing open now for four meetings.
We're going to address that.
I would just request that we close the public hearing tonight. I think some of the comments have become repetitive, and like you said, we are looking to provide responses, so I'm requesting that happen.
Understand. Thank you. All right. We want to have a discussion. We want to step back so the board can have a discussion on our letter. Okay?
Okay.
Thank you very much. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Okay, we've drafted up a letter really to talk about the architectural review. And we have some additions. I will try to get, if we haven't picked them up yet, photos of Hyde Park and Rhinebeck in there.
I can turn it down too. It would be helpful to me if we could label
because
our pictures are not labeled.
I agree.
I know
where that from. You can do that too. Kelly's going to be able to do
wonders on this
one. Which was which?
Yeah. Okay.
I'm just curious to know.
George had some comments about the letter, but I think, George, you want to talk about? We talked about specific architectural examples.
I think what we talked about. Reflecting the character. When we did the incident, there was a architectural study done pointing to specific things that would be incorporated in that design, which were ultimately deemed by the board to be representative of the community. I think the applicant would benefit from having some specific things that it needs to do. Slope roof, use of dormers to break up long periods. There's a variety of things which can be done that if you say, put these things into the plan, it's much more specific than saying, make it look like that. So it gives them sort of a checklist, something they can tell the architect, this is what you need to do. So I would think that perhaps if you're among your list of things that you're sending to Kelly, if you have architectural things about the building that really needs to be changed or added to or taken away. The brick facade is something that's, is there anything that looks like that in town? Brick does not seem to be that. If you go to Poughkeepsie, you drive up the hill, it's all brick.
It's all brick going up, yeah.
That's, you know you're in Poughkeepsie then.
But, George, when he, sent back, take a look at it because in the comments it was a slope roofs, dormers to break up roof line, clapboard, stone siding. we want to be able to give the applicant exact, I won't say exactly what we're looking for, but some of the things that we think should be included to at least give them an idea.
I think I emailed it to you.
Yeah.
Just us? Okay. We'll get it to everybody. I'll take care of that.
So you're going to fix up a letter with that?
Yeah.
Cool.
We'll get it out to everybody with the, she's got letter. George's comments. I'll send it out to everybody tomorrow. And then just bring back, if you want any changes to it. And George does mention in the beginning, if we want to give them any guidance like that, dormers, slope roofs, things of that sort.
We could also circulate the Alfondri architectural work that was done that was the baseline for Hampton Inn. So that'll give you some sense of what that kind of thing might do.
Okay.
I think the board, well, the members of the board who were on the board at that time were, I think, reasonably happy.
The second part of the question is the public hearing on it. I think I'd like the applicant to go back with the questions and documentations raised to prepare another response to that, those issues that have come up. I would expect DOT to come out with something, and we have some conversation on that. But I would like the public to get a chance to see what those responses are. So what I would propose doing is scheduling the continuation of the public hearing for the August 10th meeting, first meeting in August. This will give us, the applicant, DOT, enough to generate some of this information together and hopefully get into a baggage that we can do a better review of the issues and the responses to it and to see where we're at on it. It would also give the public a break from coming out on Monday nights for us, and let them wait till the new material comes out to see any comments on it. And hopefully the goal we're going for is to be able to do a seeker determination on the application, ensuring that we have responses and be able to do determinations of the issues that have been raised on it.
I guess the thing I'm concerned about is that I don't think there have been any new comments for quite some time, and that we need to get the applicant to respond to what's out there. And I think that people can digest that and respond in writing. I don't know, it feels like we're spinning our wheels and just...
Well, that's why we're going to take the break from the public hearing session now to give the applicant.
I'm just hoping that's not going to generate a whole another. I mean, I can't imagine what else would be generated if it hasn't been generated already. But
well, it would be good to see. I mean, I'd be interested in hearing the responses to the response.
No, definitely.
Yeah.
Definitely.
So are we at some point? It's like we have to do seeker.
The applicant would be presenting sometime prior to 8:10?
I would hope we'd have something in hand prior to 8:10.
I mean, are you asking them for a certain date to have that?
I've always put out, I don't have to ask the applicant to get it done. They're the ones who want to get the project completed.
Right, but you're saying
the emphasis should be on them to turn it around as quickly as possible.
Right, so what I'm saying is if we're going to reopen the public hearing on 8:10, are we sure that we're going to have all the information and everything ready by 8:10 before we say that?
Well, I'll put it this way. We can propose it to our 8:10. We can meet the end of July meeting and decide where we're at that stage and modify it if we have to. But I, from my perspective, issues were raised tonight, but the bulk of the issues have been raised before. The applicant should be hard at work in responding to it. We've asked them for a redesign. We've asked them for additional information tonight on it, but that, you know, we really need all that information before we begin to seek a review. But I want people to have an opportunity to review what we get. So,
when we send you the points that we think should be made, should be reviewed, should we send it to the entire board or just to you?
Send it to Kelly.
Send it to Kelly.
And what we'll do is we'll turn it around and send it back out
okay.
after we get everybody in, so you're all aware of those points. And again, take it from a seeker determination. What are the areas that we need follow up? And obviously, you know, traffic and stormwater is one. Water and sewer. You know, they're all on there. You can walk it down and see what it is. But I really want you to take a read through the transcripts and to see if we've missed anything or somebody's brought up something and said, hey, wait a minute, that's a good question and I don't think anybody's tackled it yet. So let's write it down and put it in. Let's give the applicant the opportunity. He's reviewing it too, but giving them the, where we're coming from on review of those questions. Okay, and I think.
Can I just make one? When you read the transcript, it's on page 25. Make a note of that so while we're putting all the stuff together, it's not just look back somewhere. There's a comment about page 25 of the June 10th meeting. There's a.
One of the things about the transcript is you know, page number and line number is important. And if you found something, cite it so everybody else can find it too. All right, I think that's gonna really focus in on the secret determination issues that we have there. So I would propose having a public hearing continued to August 10th on CVS, on Trans Hudson's site plan review.
So moved.
Again, thank you. Any other further discussion on it? You all in favor?
Aye.
For the audience, generally we do keep accepting written comments. I'd ask you to send any written comments to Kelly. Kelly will distribute them to the board members, but it will give us a record through the official channels of the building department. Okay, Diamond Car Wash.
Back.
Well, you're back. It's just what meetings you get to go to.
Chairman, if you don't have any other questions for me, I'll head out.
Yes, I don't have any other questions. Anybody else? No. No. Thanks, Ken.
Thank you.
Go relieve the babysitter. It's not like a subdivision. That's how the public hearing stands. We've got 11 guys.
I was interested in buying a car wash. So long. Nothing's happening.
Okay. Where are we at?
Well, we did a submission on June 1st. We went through the latest comments from the town engineer. We did one of the engineers in the office. Did a water analysis that the town engineer has been asking for. We've also added a equalization tank because of the amount of water this could potentially generate. So that was one of the comments. We added that on the plan. We've given a detail. And Based on that, we did have to add another sheet, but I kind of added the architectural elevations as part of that, so it's just two drawings now. And at this point, we're hoping for a resolution here. We want to get going.
Dave?
Like I say, we're making progress. They now have meters on both wells that are coming in to feed it, so we've got something that we can read. We know how much water is being used. The equalization tank that we were looking for is to keep the surges down at the plant. The plant is an intermittent sand filter, and it doesn't do well with big slugs coming at it. So the EQ tank would be able to take the flow and meter it out at kind of a constant rate, so it was able to treat it. What we did get on the EQ tank was something that is, I wouldn't call it an equalization, because it's a 4,000 gallon tank, but it's going to dose two times a day at 2,000 gallons each dose at 90 gallons a minute. So that's way too much. We'd like to see that.
So is there, architectural, so the guys in our office, I have two engineers in the office, they're civil, they did the design for this. So, I mean, that's fine, the 4,000 gallon tank, it seems more than adequate. Based on the numbers, it's probably not going to even really be needed. At a peak time of the year, let's say in March, February or March, when the car wash does a lot of, the automatic can run constantly. So that would make sense, but this time of year, it's going to sit idle.
Right. Part of the sizing of this tank needs to be determined by your client's business in that peak day. Right here, it's showing 3,218 gallons is the prediction of the flow. Sewer 6 plant can't take 4,000 gallons a day.
Right, and that's the whole purpose of the equalization tank, is to attenuate that.
But it's going to get 4,000 gallons a day over two periods. It's really going to hit it. What I'd rather see is have like 300 gallon doses.
So the size of the tank is okay. It's the amount that it's going to discharge.
I guess I'm not explaining it too well. I'm not sure the size of the tank is big enough.
Well, if it's 3,200 gallons potentially at its highest point, and it's a 4,000 gallon tank.
At the highest point, this isn't the peak, though. This isn't the peak day. The peak day, according to the information we had the last time, was 50-some-hundred gallons. And again, the plant can't take 4,000 gallons.
It's much larger than that. I don't know if we have enough area to put it in.
Oh, yeah. You do.
Dave, what are you thinking the plant can take? I mean, you're thinking 15, 20 gallons?
It can take about 3,000 gallons on the permit, so you need to have some storage. And what I see, the way your business, or the way his business runs, is the weekends it gets hit. During the week, not so much, unless you have one of those days that the sun's out and everybody's trying to get the salt off their cars. But mostly, if you can store what you're going to have in the weekend and pump it out during the week, you're going to be fine.
Okay. Aside from the equalization tank and the concern with the amount of water, could we make this a resolution or a condition of possibly an approval on this, so we can kind of make some headway here?
I need to get some pumping rate that's reasonable. I mean, the 2,000 gallons
I can get
at 90
you
gallons a minute, it's not going to cut it. But I think they really need to think about what the size of that tank should be. My guess, it's more than 6,000, but again, he knows his business.
Well, part of it, too, is that the applicant would like to upgrade his reclaim system. So right now it's running at 80%. So he wanted to take some of the money, you know, spend the money a little more wisely and actually upgrade the reclamation system to 90% potentially, which would decrease the amount of water that's going to be discharged. And then, you know, a 6,000 gallon tank, there's a feasibility with this project as well. There's a lot of money.
Right. There's only so much reclaim that you can use. It's like in the automatic wash, the only reclaim that you really use is the undercarriage wash. The rest of it's all fresh water. So it's
right.
Good.
The majority of the water that's reclaimed is from the
self-serve.
I don't know the exact numbers for the automatic, but he did tell me he wanted to spend some of the money to upgrade that system.
Let's work with what we got for the application site, whether he goes further and does something on the reclaim to make it more efficient. He probably has the equipment to do it, and he has to figure out how to do it. But
and he'll get paid back on that by the water bills that he pays. So it's a good investment.
All I just want to do is to see if we can get, we have one outstanding issue is just trying to
zero in on the tank size and the pumping rate.
And
I would say look at 10 times a day. That'd be like every 2 hours and pump for 20 minutes. And that's only like a 15 gallon a minute pump instead of a 90.
Can I suggest maybe what the board may want to consider is authorizing the chairman and the engineer to resolve this issue with the applicant in a way that they can presumably they can specify now, talking about dosing terms and the amount of storage over the weekend. Those can be resolved on terms that the engineer and the chairman agree are satisfactory to accomplish site plan objectives. The board could authorize you to sign it when that conclusion is reached.
That sounds great. I mean, sometimes I just feel like these small businesses come in and it drags out so long, and I just feel for them.
During the day, it's all the issue.
Yeah,
but if you understand what the issue is, and you understand what the general solution needs to be so that it's discharging in a way that doesn't impact sort of six, then if the engineer and the chairman are satisfied, I think you can delegate that authority to them. And that can be your condition.
No problem.
Now, has this water been treated, filtered, cleaned before it goes? It's just gray water by the time. No soap, no chemicals left in it.
Yes. Well,
okay. I'm okay with that. If that's the last issue, we'd let Dave solve it and you could sign the paperwork.
So,
it's middle, it's
if the solution can't be reached, you can bring it back to the board.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so we have a motion. Will someone make a motion for approval of the Diamond Car Wash site plan modifications?
Conditional
upon, what do we got this? Surge tank, pumping rate agreement between the applicant, town engineer, and the chairman to sign off at a later date.
I'll make a motion as long as I don't have to say it again.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, where are you now? With Dave and your engineer, come up with an acceptable tank size and pumping rate. Modify the site plans, and then let me know when you guys are satisfied with that I can come and sign off.
It's going to be quick, because the applicant is supposed to be here tonight. I just got married last week, and his honeymoon was supposed to end this past weekend, but he's not here, so he must have extended.
Well,
but I have some good news for him when he gets
here. That's right.
That just sounds good.
Hold on.
If the tank isn't big enough, he's going to back up, and he's going to have real problems. So that's what he has to look at.
So I guess it's going to be a little bit of dialogue back and forth. And just
and
sign
some modification in the drawings.
Right. Well, once you agree on size, then you can go in and draw it. And then submit it, and then I can sign it off.
Okay, and then we can get going and get a building permit.
But you won't have to spend Monday nights with us.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you. Good luck with the CVS.
The metering hole pressure.
Well, you're up, Thomas.
Okay.
Before going anywhere, I want to say that the map I sent you was erroneous, which I didn't figure out until several days later. It was based on a misunderstanding between me and my surveyor. So I have an alternative map here. It's only a slight change. So pass them out now.
Yep, that would work. Okay.
Map is what I want. It's not what's legally indicated. I have the other map. I gave you each two maps. The other map is what's I'm legally permitted, but which doesn't make logical sense. So I'm trying to go.
Which way? Let me get straight that I have the right two maps.
You should have another map that was sent.
I think we just... I didn't keep two. Okay. How do we tell the difference?
You should already have been given previous maps.
Oh, the previous. Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, that. Yeah, okay. I have that as soon as I get that on file on my papers. I'll put pulling that out. This is the right one.
Mm-hmm.
I want to throw out the wrong one.
So this one is not that you have, which has the 100 feet, is complies with the code.
Mm-hmm.
But this is not. This just doesn't make any sense because there's this house down here, and this land logically belongs to this house. So the way I want to do the subdivision is the way the map I just gave you.
Oh, okay.
But that does not comply, because I understand in New Paltz you're not allowed to do flag lots.
No. No, we take you out and shoot you when you do those anymore. Okay.
So I'm going for what I want is a variance. But on this map, I demonstrate that I have the ability to do a compliant...
Okay. So this one has the legal road frontage.
No, this one does. The one I just gave you does not have the legal road frontage.
This one here. Is
Access Drive is off Mountain View Place.
Yeah.
And so therefore, it only has 50
feet of William Farm.
You only have the only frontage you have is the end of pavement on Mountain View for
right.
for lot two.
Right.
And lot one is has the adequate road frontage on Route 32.
Right. So I can take 100 feet from lot one in order to create lot two, but it's just not a logical, reasonable thing to do.
That's not the map I have, right? No.
Excuse me?
That's not the map I have.
You should have two maps. You should have both of them. The one I just gave you.
See, that's what he wants to do. And the old map is, has this, in order to get a road frontage, this one says that. I'll get the right map. I'll give it time.
Yeah, this one you can just throw away.
Okay. Show that. See that map?
Yes.
Now, the way that is, he has road frontage on 32 with parcel 1 and parcel 2. It has 100-foot road frontage. But he doesn't want to cut parcel 1 like that. He wants to use, because otherwise he has to get all the way down. So he wants to tie in parcel 2 to Mountain View, the end of the flag line, end of the road, end of the pavement. But he only has 50 feet on edge of pavement tie-in there. So, let's see what we really need on going forward on this. Dave?
Took a look at it. The biggest thing is, as Tom said, is he needs a variance from the ZBA, an area variance, to be able to do this. There's some items on the plan that need to be added. EAF has got a few minor things that needs to be checked or checked differently. It's number two on the list. We need some documentation from the health department that the septic system is still valid.
That I've applied for and I'm told they will grant it, it just hasn't come to me yet.
Okay, when we see it, we're good on that.
Okay.
The area of disturbance should be shown. The topographic.
What question is that?
That is number four on page three.
Oh, he's looking at the form.
Oh.
You're looking at your memo, so.
Oh. Yeah. I've listed the things in the EAF that needs to be
changed.
Oh,
okay. That
I need a copy of this memo.
Unfortunately, that I lost.
His memo?
Oh, this, your memo.
Yeah.
Yes, no, that I have.
Okay.
I thought it was my...
This is a memo of this plan. Do you have that?
Let me see what you're looking at. Is that the letter that you wrote me?
Yeah. This is June 18th, 2015. This is what you got emailed, I guess.
Oh, I didn't get that because my email... My internet was down.
Okay.
Now you can follow along with what he's
saying.
Can I ask you a question? So where does Mountain View Place go to now that you want to extend it?
Say that
in
again.
Words, you get to Mountain View Place from Rocky Hill.
Right.
It's a paper road. It just stops.
It dead ends, right?
It's just
now.
A dead end at right. your property.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And I have received a fit permission from the town to build across the town land there.
Mm-hmm. Right. We need topographic information on all areas that are going to be disturbed, and the tile field area up here that's shown for the new house is not the same. It doesn't extend as far as the tile field that was on the approved septic plan. Need a few more shots there.
Okay, say that again. The tile field
shown here is not as big as the one that's on the approved
on the engineering plan.
It also, there was some notes on there about the slopes on the septic plan that doesn't agree with the topo that's here. So we need to have topo at least in the area that you're going to disturb. And septic field, you're definitely going to disturb that. Your primary system is the farthest east, farthest up the hill.
Say that again.
The area here that you show for the tile field,
yes.
The one that's going to be used by the house is the one that's up here, the farthest east.
Right.
So we need topo in this area to see what is happening with the grading there.
Okay.
We need to see the...
Those need to be in 2 foot or 1 foot?
2 foot. Two foot's fine. Need a field location of the tree line here. This doesn't agree with the aerial that we have on the property. It looks like it was sketched in.
Uh-huh.
So we need to see that tree line. In any place that you're going to disturb that there's trees 12 inches or greater, you need to locate those. In case there's something we can move to be able to miss something significant. Building setback lines should be shown on the lots. The new wells and septics need to all be shown. There's the well for the existing house is shown, but the existing septic isn't. The tile field and septic for the new house is shown, but the well isn't. So we need that information. Plus the location of any wells or septics that might affect where you're locating your wells and septics on neighboring properties.
There's, so all of this is written here, right?
Yeah.
Okay, great.
There's the agreement, the 2007 agreement with the town said that you needed to show the specifications for your driveway from the end of the pavement. And I'd also say talk to the town highway superintendent and make sure that this location works for him so it's not gonna mess up his snow piling activity there. Make sure it's at the location at the end of the pavement that's best for him.
Yeah, obviously you don't want the, if he's piling it back at the back end of Mountain View, you don't want him to continue doing that because you'd never get out of your house. Yeah.
So the biggest thing, again, is just the ZBA variance to be able to get this layout if this is what you want.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, it's the 100-foot frontage going down to 32.
Mm-hmm. So what? And how do I get that variance?
Well, let me, before we, we'll send you to the ZBA. And obviously we can't really do a review of the project from a public hearing and seek a termination until ZBA says, yeah, you can get the variance, and then you come back to here to go through the rest of the process on it. I did get, and you shouldn't be aware of it, we got a couple of comments from the New Falls Trading Post, which is down there on Hickory Hill. And what I did was I cut and paste. He's concerned about, let's see, he said his septic said the septic system must be in the back of his lot because the well for his store is on the side near Hickory Hill. Therefore, you can't put a well near the back of Hickory Lane. I don't think you do, but that's where he was. And then he followed that up with a second one. And what the septic field for my store, the trading post, is in the extreme southwest corner of the store property near the property line. So any driveway that the subdivision has to take that into account. No, he, you got to go, it's, yeah, 32. It would be that one on the corner.
10?
10.
Well, there's no intention to put a driveway down there. So.
No, I just said, he raised these questions. Right. I'll give you this, and just got to say, the present plan doesn't have anything there, and that the wells, we can say that the wells are located. Right, but that's, you should be aware of the comments that were raised. We do, we will have a public hearing. He may come out for a public hearing on it, and vocally say that, but we got that in the mail. I just want to keep you abreast of that. Board have any comments on it at this stage?
No.
Would the board like to make a recommendation to the ZBA, and whether they think this is a good idea, better than, or is the board neutral? We generally have either we're neutral on it, let the ZBA decide, or we, you know, we give a recommendation that we think this makes sense, this plan, as opposed to the long lot line.
I feel like it makes sense.
I don't have an objection to the road.
Oh, the road's there, yeah.
That's what the variance is for, right?
Variance is that he only has a 50-foot frontage on that road, and you need a 100-foot frontage. If he goes to a 100-foot, if he's required for a 100-foot frontage, he has to...
Do the other one
by bringing it all the way down to 32.
Right. So this option, I think, is...
Which is really the front yard of the existing house. Mm-hmm. It's really a lousy option.
This is probably a better option than that.
Okay.
What is the distance from that corner to that house?
50 feet. It's 50 feet from the corner to the well.
Mm-hmm. Mountain View Place is a paved road.
Yes.
Mountain View?
Yeah.
They just repaved it.
Yeah. Yeah, so one of those. Is it paved all the way to that lot? It is.
Yeah.
Okay.
This is the infamous Rocky Hill.
No, I know the road. It's
all these little that go nowhere. On it.
In fact, it's probably actually 75 feet because it's a.
Oh, he's got the hammerhead at the end of it. Okay. All right. So what we'll do is we'll forward this to the ZBA. They will have a meeting on it. They will schedule a public hearing. You'll have to go make a presentation to them on it. They'll make a quote-unquote recommendation, but they won't vote on it. They'll send it back to us saying, you know, if they agree with it, they'll say it's a good idea. We'll go ahead with our seeker determination on a two-lot subdivision, and we have to schedule a public hearing for it also. So we'll go through that process, and we'll continue. If we approve it, we'll be contingent upon the ZBA approving it. But they'll wait till we have finished seeker. So we'll end up doing a seeker, they won't. So you won't get an answer, an official vote on it, until after we finish the seeker. But they'll tell you how they're going to vote. So you'll know. Okay.
About how soon would I know?
Well, I'll put it this way. It is now. You'll get on the ZBA. I'm checking the circuit time. The ZBA's agenda for July. They'll schedule a public hearing in August. After that public hearing, depending on how lengthy their agenda is, they'll review your project. With that review, you'll come back here. And then we'll go through we'll schedule a public hearing. I don't like to schedule it too far in advance because, you know, ZBA if it rains or they didn't have a quorum or something else, things get pushed in. We meet once a month, so things can get pushed back. So I'll wait till they get to that stage. We'll schedule a public hearing. We meet twice a month, so we'll schedule a public hearing for a review of the project that way. Okay? We do a... a tally just to keep us straight, and we'll just ask you to sign on the dotted line, and you can get a copy, and so we know where we're going on this thing. Okay.
And everything I need to do is on this.
Well, yes. I think we just made the notes for here. But everything that's on Dave's memo, you got to bring it up to date and be responsive to it. Okay?
Okay.
Thank you.
Very much.
Good night. Board members. A couple of questions have come up. George has given me this about having discussions either with the applicant or with people.
Administrative?
It's on the administrative agenda.
No, this is now the administrative.
Now the administrative agenda. Okay.
We'll the entertainment portion.
Okay. We'll take this in a minute. I just want to close out the meeting tonight. So we'll have a motion to close the meeting tonight.
I'll make a motion.
I'll second it.
Okay. All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Closing meeting. Okay. Questions have come up. And